In this problem, we have a non-isothermal CSTR with two liquid phase reactions. Keep in mind, a non-isothermal CSTR means that the feed temperature is different from the temperature inside the tank, but the temperature inside the tank is constant everywhere. So we're given information about the feed, the density of the feed, flow rate, heat capacity, and we want a selectivity of 6 with these two reactions. We want selectivity, namely the rate of formation of B divided by the rate of formation of product C. We want that number to be 6. So first thing we do is draw a diagram to represent the process. And I've labeled the feed stream, volume of the reactor. I've also labeled the unknowns, the temperature, the outlet concentration of reactant, and the heat removal. And so this is a multi-step solution. First, we're going to use the selectivity of 6. We're going to use that to determine the temperature, because as we change the temperature, since the reactions have different activation energies, we're going to change the selectivity. Well, once we know the temperature, we can calculate K1 and K2. Then we're going to use a mass balance on A, and this allows us to determine the exit concentration from the reactor. Then we have enough information to substitute into the energy balance and calculate Q dot, the dot indicating it's a rate, the rate of heat removal. So let's first look at the selectivity calculation. So the flow rate of B leaving the reactor corresponds to how fast we're making B, since a steady state process. So flow rate of B is here, and the flow rate of C is here, the exit of the reactor. So molar flow rate. And how fast we're producing B is the rate constant for this first reaction, times the concentration, since it's first order, times the volume of the reactor. We know it's first order because of the units for the rate constant. And likewise for the molar flow rate of C, of course the CAs and the Vs cancel, so the selectivity ratio, which is 6, is just the ratio of these rate constants, where the only unknown is temperature, so we should be able to solve now for temperature after substituting in the equations for the rate constant. So I've substituted in the values for the rate constants. I brought the pre-exponentials to the right side to get this term, and then I combine the exponentials, solve for temperature. So first part, this is the temperature in the reactor. Now we can go back and calculate the values of the rate constants by substituting temperature into the exponential. So here are the values for K1 and K2. We of course have to use absolute temperature in the exponential. And then it's always good to check. If we look at the ratio of K1 over K2, this is indeed 6.0. So our next step is to write down a material balance, a mass balance on A. So this is a balance on A. It's steady state, so no accumulation. A comes into reactor. This is the concentration. This is the volumetric flow rate. So the product is the molar flow rate. And the molar flow rate leaving, since it's liquid phase, the volumetric flow rate is constant. The concentration, which is what we're trying to determine. And the reason for the change, because we have two reactions. K1 times Ca, V, rate constant, concentration, volume, and K2, Ca, V. Now we know all the numbers except for Ca, so we can solve this now for Ca. So I've substituted numbers along with units to make sure that the units are consistent and everything is in moles per minute. So I can solve for the concentration of A. So we can see we have a high conversion of A in this reactor. Now we can go back and use this in the energy balance. So again, at steady state, we have energy coming in We have to raise the temperature of the feed to reactor temperature. So the density times the volumetric flow rate is a mass flow rate times a mass heat capacity times the temperature difference. We have heat of reaction, the rate constant, and this is the heat of reaction for the first reaction, times the rate of the first reaction. The heat of reaction for the second reaction times the rate for the second reaction. And the sign notation is to make things consistent. We can derive this energy balance, and we do in other screencasts. But think of this in terms of this term for our system is going to be negative because our reactor temperature is higher than our feed temperature. We're taking energy out of the system to heat it up. This term is going to be positive because it's an exothermic reaction, which means delta H is negative. And likewise, this term is going to be positive because same reason. And the only other term in the equation is the rate of heat removal. So we know all the values except for Q dots. Now we can substitute into this equation and solve for Q dot. So here I've substituted in the values along with their units, which is always a good idea. Notice that I made the feed temperature absolute since I have the reactor temperature in Kelvin. And so now I can just do the math to calculate the value for Q dot. So here's the rate of heat removal, probably two significant figures is all we can legitimately justify based on the data. And by a systematic approach, we're able to calculate the heat removal in this CSTR.